Hello, everyone. We are going to go ahead and get started. Welcome to our part one webinar on plugins. My name is Lexi, and I'm just going to be kind of the technical support behind this webinar. We are so excited that you are here today, and I just want to remind everyone of some few housekeeping items. First and foremost, we are recording this webinar, and we will share the recording with you after the event. If you have any questions for our panel and for Doc, who is our moderator and host today, please use the question and answer feature in your Zoom toolbar. Other than that, if you have any comments or want to kind of join in the conversation, we have our webinar chat going. Feel free to hop in there, tell us where you're tuning in from, and all of that jazz. With that being said, this is part one of a three-part series. If you're registered for part one, you're welcome to join us on part two and part three. Today, our topic is going to be Plugins 101, taking you through the basics of plugins and everything WordPress. Thanks to those that have answered our poll, giving us a great idea of kind of what your knowledge is with plugins. And then for the next 2 weeks, we'll be having some additional sessions. Next week, we will be talking on making the most of e-commerce and WooCommerce plugins with a great panel of experts there. And then on Tuesday, the 29th, we will kick off artificial intelligence plugins, what we're seeing, what to be leery of. So lots of topics and lots of plugins coming at you this month. With that being said, this is our lovely panel today, moderated and hosted by Doc Pop, who's a content creator and podcast host here at WP Engine. And then the rest of our panel you can see listed above. At this point, I'm going to turn it over to Doc. Doc, you can take the stage and take it away from here.
Right on. Thank you so much, Lexi. Howdy, everyone. I'm your host, Doc. I host a show called Press This for WP Engine. It's a weekly podcast. As well, I do a live stream called the Torque Social Hour for torquemag.io. I've been using WordPress for about 15 years, just as my personal site of choice, my blog of choice. And I will be on location with the rest of the Torque team and several folks from WP Engine at WordCamp US. We'll be filming videos all throughout the event and posting those to social and as well to our YouTube channel. And that's it. I'm your host for today. And let's get on to the agenda for what we're going to be discussing today. We are going to have a discussion with the panelists later in, and we're going to ask these experts questions about how they feel, best practices, things that you should know about plugins. After that, we're going to get to Q&As from the audience, but we're going to kick this off with just a very high-level guide to how to get into installing plugins and maintaining plugins, just for folks who may not have gone through the steps yet. That's what our goal is for the beginning part of this. So let's get into that. All right. And here we have just some examples of some of the popular plugins that you can find. These are all viewable on wordpress.org/plugins. This happens to be, I think, the 12 most popular plugins currently in the store. You've got things like Yoast, Akismet, Jetpack. And what a plugin does for WordPress is it adds new flavors, new possibilities to your WordPress site. So you can have a WordPress site and you can turn it into an e-commerce site by installing WooCommerce. You can improve your SEO by installing Yoast SEO, which will help give you all the tools to get better search engine optimization. Tools like Akismet are great for reducing spam. There's a lot of stuff here. So we are just showing you currently the most popular plugins in the free WordPress plugin repository. And we're going to talk about later how you can find other plugins as well, and how you can find plugins other than the popular plugins. But let's go on to the next slide. All right. So installing a plugin, what you always want to do is open your dashboard, and you can find that top left here, and click on dashboard, and then you're going to scroll down to plugins and add new. Now, from here, you'll already see some suggested plugins. These are the featured plugins that most users see. You can also click on popular to see the list that we were just looking at with Yoast and Contact Form 7 and all of those. You can Also, as you're going through here, you can choose to search plugins, which is what I think most people do. I don't think you're going to just find stuff from the plugin suggestions and go from there. This is a good starting point, but most people go here and type in something. In this case, I'm looking for a post duplicator. And this is Yoast Duplicate Post, which allows you to easily take a previous post that you published and create a new copy of it. But from here, you're actually seeing all the things that show up with duplicate. And so we can look here. Yoast Duplicate Post was recently updated about a week ago. That's a thing that you always want to find, is something that's being maintained, something that's compatible with your website. You can check on ratings and kind of compare all the different duplicate posts. You can click on more info and be able to see more details from here as well. And from here, if you like, you have chosen a plugin, you can click the Install Now button from here and it is installed. So let's go to the next slide. When you're choosing your plugins, you can select more details. That opens up that pop-up. And like I was saying earlier, the things you're looking for are, is it compatible with your current version? From this panel, you can find installation suggestions, which oftentimes installation is just as easy as installing and activating it, but sometimes it's a little more complex. Reviews are going to be great. Take them with a grain of salt. You want to go through quite a few and get an idea of what you're looking at. When you're installing a plugin, especially for the WordPress plugin repository, some of these are maintained from large companies and some of them are single developers. And sometimes the single developer ones are doing just as good a job with being able to maintain and support everything. But you can really get a good idea from checking out the reviews and, you know, on a very high level, just checking out the stars at the top. As far as best practices, once you've installed an update, once you've installed a plugin, it's going to be showing up on your plugin page. And this is also where you can access things like update. You can see which of your plugins need to be updated. It is very important to keep, in my opinion, all of your plugins up to date. An out-of-date plugin could mean security risk. It could have bugs that have been patched since then. What I recommend is using enable auto updates. And I just do this for everything. So here I'm bulk selecting. I'm going to quickly save. If you're a WP Engine customer, then you know that oftentimes before you make a big change, you have a chance to save your state. I'm just going to create a simple little backup here. And a few minutes later, I will have gotten an email saying that everything is ready to go and I can safely make changes to my site and know that I have a saved copy. But like I said, enable auto updates is a great way to make sure that your site's just automatically updating itself. And I think it's a great thing. This back in the past, this would have been maybe a riskier thing, but at this point, plugins tend to work pretty stable. I really recommend using enable auto updates. And if you do have issues, you can always go back to your previous state if your host allows that. Now, as well as keeping plugins up to date, I do recommend that you deactivate plugins that you're no longer using. And if you're deactivating them, might as well delete them too. You really don't need to have a bunch of plugins running, or not even running, but just on your site that you're not using anymore. It's just a best practice to, if you're not using a plugin, just go ahead and deactivate it, delete it. I used to have a lot less plugins. I have a lot on my personal site right now because I'm connected to the Fediverse, which has a whole suite of plugins. This one, I just want to show a shout out to Wapoo Dashboard Pet. This is a plugin. It's free in the repository. If you install it and activate it, it helps let you know that your site is up to date, and it does so by showing you a cute Wapoo on the bottom of your page. It's like a little mochi pet for WordPress. I love it. So that's going to be it for like my one shout out to Wapoo Dashboard Pet for just encouraging us to keep our sites up to date. And let's go on to one more slide. Everything I've shown you so far has been from the WordPress repository, and I searched from it within the dashboard. You can also download from other sites. So in this case, I'm on EveryAlt, which is using AI to help provide alternative descriptions for images. You download from there, and then you go to plugins, add new, and upload plugin. And the file that you downloaded should be a zip file. because you can only upload zip files as plugins. So make sure that you don't like uncompress it and try to find something from there. You're going to upload the whole zip file and click install now. And you can install from other websites, like I said, WordPress repository or just using the dashboard search. Those are kind of how I do a lot of my search, but there are other places you can go. You want to make sure that you're relying on trusted websites, people that you know, developers that you know that have good reputations. Sometimes you might find stuff on GitHub that you might play around with. That's an example of some place that you might download. WooCommerce has its own extension store that you can download from. As well, you know, professional plugin developers oftentimes host their own sites, including Every Alt, which in this case, I believe they're hosting it on their own because they're still kind of making the product perfect before they put it into the repository. But other times you might actually have a developer who has a paid product, and the only way to be able to get that would be to go through their site. And finally, we're just going to give a shout out to WP Engine Smart Plugin Manager. This is a tool that helps keep track, update your themes and plugins. This tool also does a visual regression test. Now, the enable auto updates that I was talking about before is a great way to just be able to kind of keep things moving smoothly and uploading, updating plugins. But occasionally you might find that there's some change to your site that breaks. Well, the visual regression test is actually going to do that test for you. So if you have the Smart Plugin Manager installed, then it's going to automatically update at night, and it's going to run a quick visual test to just check the layout of your page. And if it looks like something's broken, if it looks like blocks aren't working right, or you know there's some bad error with your site, it's going to automatically roll back for you and just let you know, hey, like we tried installing this and we noticed this issue, and you can go forward manually if you want. All right. And with that, I think that is just a very high level kind of guide into how to install plugins. And since we have these experts here today, these are all folks who have been in the plugin community for a while and have a lot of great insight. I'm going to start this off with a couple questions for them, and then we're going to get to your questions. So remember to drop those in the chat, and we'll try to add those at the end of the show. We have several great folks here from Brizzy, Karamus, OptinMonster, and Gravity Forms. Let's get started. I'm going to let each guest introduce themselves and just tell us about themselves. And maybe, if you don't mind, panelists, the first plugin you can remember installing on your WordPress site, just quickly, if you can remember that. So Dimi, let's start with you. Why don't you tell us about yourself?
Hey guys, thanks for having me, Doc. Hi everyone. I'm Dimi Baitanchuk. I'm the CEO and one of the co-founders here at Brizzy. We are developing this, you might have heard of it, it's a WordPress website builder called Brizzy. It's a plugin, so you will install it as Doc very kindly showed us in his tutorial, and you are using Brizzy to create your own website. I'm in this space, in the WordPress space, I think from 2007, and together with my partners, we've built a couple of businesses across the years around WordPress, around this excellent ecosystem with Brizzy, with PixelKit, and in 2018, I think, we started Brizzy for WordPress. And here we are in 2023, still going strong, and that's all, I think.
Right on. Did you say the first plugin? I missed that.
To be honest, I can't even remember. It was so long ago, so it's 16 years ago.
Right. Well, if you remember that later, we'll get to it. Daniel, let's get to you. Why don't you tell us about yourself, and if you can remember the first plugin that you installed.
Yeah, sure. I'm Daniel Dayton. I work for Karamus in Raleigh, North Carolina. We're an agency, so we do from like full service agency, so from branding all the way to development of websites and applications. We also have a product called Jewelbug, which is an app that kind of does social engagement to promote sustainable life decisions. So we are more of a consumer in most cases of plugins in an agency setting, but we also maintain a couple plugins internally. The first plugin I remember installing was probably Contact Form 7, but since we've kind of switched to Gravity Forms, so that's me.
Right on. Yeah, Contact Form 7 is one of those popular plugins that we saw. And We were researching them a little bit, and it's kind of funny. That was a very popular plugin early on that's still around. It's got this long tail. And that's just a single developer who's maintaining that, like one of the most popular plugins in the repository. Angie, can you tell us about yourself and your first plugin?
Sure. So I'm Angie Meeker, general manager at OptinMonster and TrustPulse. And OptinMonster is a SaaS company that works with WordPress as well, that helps you grow your email list and leads and sales from the traffic already coming to your website. And TrustPulse is a social proof app for e-commerce stores that helps your people understand what people are buying on your website, helps visitors understand what people are buying on your website. I've been in the WordPress industry since a really long time. I think since maybe like 2005, six, almost the beginning, and helped start our meetup here in Columbus, Ohio, and then moved on to helping organize our WordCamp and helping then some of the other cities in Ohio start their meetups and WordCamp. So been around for a while and excited to be here. And the first plugin, I'm pretty sure it was a Kismet. Mm-hmm. It's always the first plugin I install on any site. So I bet that was probably it.
Angie, thanks for organizing events, and also shout out to the Ohioans. I know that we have quite a few in the chat. Travis, can you tell us a little bit about yourself and your first plugin that you remember installing?
Yeah, absolutely. I'm Travis Tots, Director of Brand and Marketing at Gravity Forms, located in Virginia Beach, Virginia, which is where our office is, but we're generally a remote-based company. Gravity Forms is our main flagship tool. We also last year acquired Gravity Flow, which is a marketing automation tool that's built on top of Gravity Forms. And actually, we're in the process of releasing Gravity SMTP, which is an SMTP tool that we're adding to our plugin suite. Been in the industry, like Andy, OG to the space. It was about 2005, 2006, and kind of started building themes. And then kind of continue to work my way through various iterations in the space. My first plugin, I think, was probably Breadcrumb Nav XT, which John Havlick built, who's a Minnesotan, just like myself. Great plugin. I had this project, this agency project. They needed breadcrumbs. I was like, what's breadcrumb? Anyways, it's a fantastic plugin. Still in the repo today, actually. So.
I love seeing the other panelists all nod their heads. I think some people remember this. And speaking of the panelists, let's switch to our panelist view here. And I'm going to ask a few questions. I think first off, I want to know how many plugins are too many plugins. I was mentioning on my slides, I feel embarrassed. I have like 20 plugins now. And I used to have this hardcore rule, you know, 10 plugins, keep it limited. And then I got the ActivityPub suite, which is a suite of like seven other plugins. And that's just broken everything for me. But I want to hear from an expert. Dimi, why don't you tell us, what do you think is too many plugins?
Well, it's hard to give you an exact number, right? Because this too many phrase can vary depending on multiple things or multiple factors. What I would try to do is keep a very tight grip on your plugins, right? So, and do your job with as few as possible, right? We always advise our customer, clients, and friends, and whoever asks us or me, is sort of to keep in mind a couple of points when you are installing new plugins on your website, because the decision is sort of taken from that perspective. So for example, if you're thinking about performance, each plugin is adding some code on your website, right? So that can affect loading times and overall performance of your website and the code quality that is put there. Security is another concern, right? I don't want to be the naysayer here, but plugins potentially introduce an entry point to hackers. So if you have many plugins, that might be a concern that you need to keep in mind. Also maintenance. If you have multiple plugins, you need to maintain them, update them, ensure WordPress compatibility. And this is another factor that you need to keep in mind. Just to wrap it up, I would use only essential plugins that do the job for your website or for your business that are also built by reputable companies, because this is important. So you can ensure that the code is of quality, and keep them updated. This is important to keep them up to date. You need to aim for quality rather than quantity, and always back everything up. This is all I have to say about too many plugins.
Mm-hmm. And Dimi, you brought up a point that maybe it's not necessarily about the quantity of plugins that you have, but making sure that if you do have, you know, plugins, that they're all that being used, or things you're using, and that none of them are security risk. And in particular, there you want to see if a plugin hasn't been updated in 4 years, maybe reevaluate if you still want to be using that plugin. It might be literally the only plugin that does that one thing you do, but quite often you'll find others. So maybe it's not necessarily about the quantity, but we do have a poll up: how many plugins is too many plugins? And in the chat, I'm seeing a lot of people say 80 as pretty normal. So I'm feeling a little better about my 20 on my personal site. Dan, I'm gonna ask you the same question. Do you have any thoughts on how many plugins is too many?
Yeah, sure. I mean, I, you know, kind of just echoing what Dimi said, I think it really kind of depends. Sometimes the count is a little misleading because, for instance, like with Gravity Forms, you know, there's a lot of extensions, so you're not really adding a ton of functionality, but you might have that count get pretty high with some of the extensions. So, like, I think the most important thing whenever we're assessing plugins is really like what functionality we're trying to get, and then make sure that we either find a plugin that covers several different things we're trying to do with the plugin, or one that, like you're saying, is reputable. So we try and really limit the ones we introduce, just because, as you know, we work on client sites. We need to make sure that we're not introducing any security vulnerabilities or any you know, potential, like if we're hinging a bunch of our business logic on someone else's plugin that's not being supported, that's an issue for us. So like everyone else has said here, just make sure that the plugin's being you know, updated, and as you know, as much as you can, that if you know it has good code quality, usually the stars, like we've already said, are a good way to make sure that it's a good plugin. But yeah, I mean, we do have sites, especially once you get into the e-com space, where, you know, we're plus 30 plugins without a doubt, just to kind of get all the functionality the customer wants. But for the most part, I think the less plugins the better, just because as Dimi said, you know, you're introducing a bunch of code that's running on every page load, which is going to affect performance. So you really just take a hard look at what you're trying to accomplish and make sure that you know, you're making wise choices. We obviously have customers that will just go ahead and, you know, add like five different page builders just because they want to try them out, and this is on a production site. So like those sort of decisions, you know, if you have a staging environment, try the plugins out there first. But in general, yeah, the less the better, in my opinion, you know, if you can do it. So that's my two cents.
And in the chat, Lisa Ryan says, I don't think you can pick a number, it just depends on the site, which I think we're kind of finding here. And also, I saw a message that the WooCommerce plugins, oftentimes when you start getting into the extensions there, then you might have some crazy, like there's a lot more. So like if my site was a WooCommerce site, I might have far more plugins than I have now. So just, I guess the general rule of thumb is make sure that you're only using what you need, and you're making sure that you're keeping on top of how up to date they are, and deleting and deactivating things you're no longer using. Now, if a plugin isn't working as expected, if someone runs into an issue, what is the best way for that user to handle it? I'm going to pass this question to Travis and see if you have any thoughts there.
Yeah. Troubleshoot. Generally speaking, if a plugin isn't working, it's usually a conflict. So, you know, the easiest way to try to break down that barrier is to troubleshoot against other installed plugins and sometimes installed themes. You know, oftentimes if it's a plugin that has functionality built into it and no front end views, you're probably dealing with maybe a JavaScript conflict of some sort against another plugin. I often would tell people one by one, just activate like alongside something else and then see if it's working. That generally is the easiest way to go about it, even if it takes some time. You know, depending on the level of knowledge, you know, you can definitely do things like install a plugin to actually help you troubleshoot another plugin. There's things like Query Monitor, things like that, that actually exist, some in the repo and some, of course, outside the repo, the .org repo, that is, that will allow you to actually see some conflicts. So, you know, they'll give you a flag or actually show red status. Usually it's, like I said, you know, code related conflict, JavaScript or otherwise. So yeah, troubleshooting might take you some time.
And if you do find an issue with a plugin, when is it good to like reach out to the developers? Is that like a welcome thing for most developers?
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, a lot of hosts nowadays will do auto updates, right? So usually, you know, I would say one of the first steps should be, you know, to make sure that your plugins are up to date. If you're seeing a conflict, and if not, start that troubleshooting path. And most of the time, like if you still can't get it to work after a troubleshooting phase and you really need this specific plugin, check if it's been updated. And I'm sure we'll probably get to that in various conversations today, but check if it's been updated in a while, if it hasn't, or if there's maybe kind of a relatively important issue that you're seeing on your site and you want to let other people know, but reach out. You know, it's important for us plugin and authors, theme and plugin authors, to really know when there's issues so that we can patch them and address them for our customers, right? Like hundreds of thousands of sites, you know, millions of sites in some cases running various plugins. It's important. You know, these types of things are important to definitely try to communicate. Obviously, we're all human. These pieces of code in most cases are written by a human hand, maybe by AI, you never know. But in a lot of cases written by a human hand. So there are things that you're going to see, you know, it's important to try to share that knowledge when you can, and when you're running into something, so folks like us can help and fix issues.
And Travis, you were talking about, something I hadn't thought about, which I've done. I think a lot of us have done. If there's an issue, oftentimes it comes down to two plugins not playing well with each other. And you were saying you go through and deactivate one at a time. I do want to give a shout out to Peter Bailey's in the comments, who says he prefers doing a binary search on development site where he deactivates half of his plugins and checks the site. If it's still working, he goes and does the other half and then narrows it down. That's some smart thinking there.
That is some smart thinking. Yeah, that's troubleshooting. It's great. That's a great tactic though for sure.
Now, earlier on in the show, I talked about how there are places you can get plugins for other plugins. Like you can go to the WooCommerce's site and get they call them WooCommerce extensions. There are sometimes ecosystems around a plugin, and it's very interesting. You get into something like WooCommerce, or I guess MailChimp has some other ones. There's all these different ones that there's the plugin, and then there's this ecosystem around it. And Angie, I was actually wondering if you could tell us a little bit about this because of your experience with Optin Monster, which is oftentimes one of those plugins that does work with other plugins, right?
That's right, yeah. So when we're talking about how many plugins is too many, there's a temptation. You should know this for plugin authors. There's a temptation to just cram it all into one big plugin. And if you're not really laser focused on the problem that your plugin is trying to solve, you will give in to that temptation. And if you don't know your customers well enough, you'll give in to that temptation to just cram it all into one plugin. And that's when you end up, when you install a plugin and you realize, oh my gosh, this has like 800 things I'm never going to use. I don't need, and they're just filling up my site with bloat, basically. So what happens over time is that both the plugin author develops add-ons for their plugin that expand the functionality of the core plugin, or other plugin authors who are not even part of the company that developed the original plugin say, I want to hook into that plugin and add functionality for my plugin that's related to your plugin. So for Optin Monster, a really good example of this is MemberPress. So MemberPress is a membership and course software, and they came to us and said, hey, our people want to use Optin Monster to do this very specific thing. They want to show pop-ups and campaigns to people who are enrolled in courses or specific memberships. Well, that's not something that we are going to build into Optin Monster because it's not our primary use case, but it makes a lot of sense for MemberPress users to be able to do that. So we worked with MemberPress, and now essentially there's an additional piece of OptinMonster that works specifically for MemberPress. And I think you see that with a lot of different plugins where the plugin authors know that they have to stay really focused. And so the way to do that, keep the core plugin really light and lean and create this essentially an ecosystem around it that begins to fulfill all the various use cases that aren't part of the core use case. And then again, that opens up for other people in the WordPress community to extend it even further, which I think is pretty great. WooCommerce is probably one of the best examples of this. A lot of the e-commerce plugins, you see this really clearly, whether it's Woo or EDD or other plugins like that, you see that extension happening really well and really easily. Mm-hmm. Which you couldn't do, you know, like you think back to when we bought software in boxes, right? And it came and the software was just what shipped in the box. And if you needed it to do something different, just tough luck, you know, but that's the kind of the joy of open source is that we get the ability to take that code and do what we want with it and extend it to do what we want with it, which I think is pretty fantastic.
I love that you mentioned bloat, which is a thing that comes up with plugins. And so on one hand, you know, a philosophy a developer might have is to just make sure this plugin has everything, everything and then some. And on the other hand, it's for the developer to release a core product, minimal product, and then let people add those extensions, you know, add WooCommerce, for instance, doesn't have the ability to handle pre-orders, kind of like Kickstarter style pre-orders, but there's plugins that allow you to do that, but not everyone wants that. And it does actually kind of clutter up your site. It would make it harder to navigate on the dashboard side, it makes it harder to use. So it is kind of cool to see those two philosophies take place where some folks do just try to cram everything in there. I feel like I got to say Jetpack has a reputation for that, for having a lot of things going, but I actually honestly think everything in Jetpack is something I do need. So I'm not necessarily complaining about that. I'm like, Jetpack's an easy solution for a lot of install stuff, but you know, for some folks, they might just need one specific element of that. And, you know, they might be able to find that somewhere else and not have to install a whole suite of things. So that is one of the cool parts.
Mm-hmm. Sorry. And so even Jetpack over the years, though, to their praise, has begun splitting out pieces of it, right? And letting people make more decisions rather than making decisions for them, which I think is great. Yeah, that's a good example of like this one plugin does a lot. And maybe that's good for you and maybe it's bad. It's your own decision, right? Whether that's the right choice for you.
And some of these plugins that we're talking about, I believe WooCommerce, because we keep mentioning it, have like developer programs. They very much want to have an ecosystem that's trustworthy, and they make it easy for developers to work with them and try to kind of like have something that sounds very respectable. Dan, I think you were maybe talking a little bit about how the advantages of hooks and filters and what's unique in the WordPress space about that. Can you tell us a little bit more about that?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think that's one of the coolest things about the WordPress community, especially, you know, with plugins that are really well built, is they expose most of their logic to places you can inject your code. So those are called hooks and filters in WordPress. And that's actually how the plugins get implemented in the flow of like how the page loads. So WordPress plugins themselves tap into these hooks and filters that WordPress runs. And then most of the really good plugins will have these hooks and filters where you can inject your own logic into what the plugin's doing. So, you know, at Keramis, we do a ton of that with different plugins. And, you know, it's one of the coolest things about WordPress 100% that, you know, you have this opportunity to leverage what other people have put out there and then kind of make it your own as need be. So yeah, it's just really amazing.
Yeah. During my presentation, I talked a little bit about the red flags that I have. The things that I'm checking for when I'm looking for plugins are, I want to make sure that they're recently updated and they're compatible with my version and that they have maybe a large number of reviews and positive reviews. These are what I look for in a plugin. I'm kind of curious if maybe anybody has any red flags for plugins. Dan, maybe I'll toss this back to you. Do you have anything that if you are looking at a plugin, you're like, no, this is something I'm not going to install on my site?
Yeah, I mean, like we've talked about here a bunch already. Like, if it hasn't been updated a couple of years, like that's a red flag right there. I'm not gonna touch it. I sometimes I get, you're saying you kind of do have to go that route, but The other one is like, we will take a look at like pokes and filters and like what we can actually customize. I feel like if there is not a lot of, like for us in particular, since, you know, we're agency and there's probably something we need to tweak, if there's not really much opportunity within the plugin, we'll probably search for another one. So like, for instance, there are a couple of events plugins. We went through kind of the gauntlet of like assessing which ones were the best. And, you know, we kind of end up choosing the one that kind of had the most like ability for us to kind of, you know, inject some code that we needed without having to kind of roll around. So for us personally, that's one route that we kind of take a hard look at. And then, you know, outside of that, like you're saying, the stars, it's just like, if you were responding into supports and you see like constantly the plugins moving forward, that's another one that's like, yeah, we'll go ahead and roll with that one instead of something that maybe has sitting with a bunch of issues that aren't being addressed.
Angie, do you have any green flags? Anything that when you see in a plugin, is exactly what you're looking for, you know to trust it?
Well, okay. So I would say two things. Number one, look at their reviews, right? Like if you look at their reviews and you see just a bunch of terrible reviews specifically about their service, right? If you see reviews about the developers are not responding quickly, and when they do, you can see how the developer responds if they're not trying to address issues, then I think that's a pretty good red flag for me. And the other, it's not as much a red flag, it's the other way around, it's the green flag, is once you find a plugin developer that you trust. So let's say that we're looking at Gravity Forms, right? If you find that you like Gravity Forms, be sure to explore their other options, their other offerings, right? A lot of times you'll get a plugin that's in a niche and they solve one problem, but they also understand other problems that you have as their type of customer. And so they have other plugins that address other problems that you have too. And instead of going and looking way outside of that ecosystem or that company, you can look within that company to see, do they offer other products? Ask them, what do you recommend? What plugin do you recommend for this? You know, because if you trust that person or that developer who built a plugin you really like and enjoy, they very well have a good recommendation for you for what other products you can use that you would trust. But as far as red flags, for sure, support is a big one for me. Mm-hmm. And not just the number of support replies, because here's the thing. You can't just look at the number of support replies. OptinMonster is a good example of this. A lot of our support doesn't even flow through .org. It comes directly into our own Help Scout ticketing system. So we've been around for 10 years. We have 40 tickets on .org. And so if you look at that, you think, oh, this is not a supported plugin, when in reality, we've had tens of thousands of tickets, right, over that amount of time, but you just don't see it on .org. So make sure that you actually like pay attention to where does this company provide support so that you can get a better idea there. I would say definitely support and reviews and that type of thing, but you don't necessarily pay attention to just the number on .org because it doesn't always tell the whole story.
In the chat, Marie Kalanda says a no-go for her is a poor response time in forms for support. Which goes along with what you're saying. And then Peter Bailey also says, a general rule of thumb for me is no plugin or theme should be larger than WordPress core. Just saying, I think I could go with that. Let's talk a little bit. We talked about the WordPress repository, which is wordpress.org/plugins. That is not the only place to get plugins. That is the place that you can easily access from within your dashboard. That's a great place to see like a large hub of free plugins. But should users only be downloading from WordPress.org, or should they occasionally check out other sites as well? I'll let Travis answer this one.
Yeah, I mean, it's a great question. I think the repo on .org is a great place to start, right? For a lot of folks, whether it's people that are just getting started and they're beginners, or maybe it's something specific you're looking for, or you're looking for a free option. You know, of course, I will argue for premium paying for premium plugins. You know, Gravity Forms has always been a premium plugin, so we are not located on the .org repo, but that has been since the beginning. You know, and for us, it really allowed us to create both a plugin as well as a support system for our customers a long time ago. That we've been able to stand by and stand true throughout our history. So yeah, it's tough. You know, I mean, I think look at sites. WP Beginner is a great resource, right? See what the 5 or 10 best X are. Search Google, like do some research to find out what is best for you in those given scenarios where you need something that does something specific, add functionality, or maybe it does something on the front end that applies to the project or the work that you've got in front of you. You know, premium plugins are certainly something that you have to pay for, but it is, in a lot of cases, it's worth it, right? I mean, you're paying for the support, the updates, and of course, you know, helping to support the people that build these tools that are allowing you to accomplish your task and projects as well. A lot of things exist outside of .org. You just have to look a little bit and then be comfortable to spend a little bit, or making sure that you take care of those expenses and pass them on to your clients as a part of your project, so that, yeah, you're allowing those projects to happen the best way that they can, and you're finding the best resources.
Yeah, I tend to think that, at least my personal experience, you know, it's a open source software and I got it for free, and the first batch of plugins are all free. I think somewhere in my mind, I got locked into this, you should only be free. And then, you know, not really thinking about like, we need to sustain these things. And maybe, you know, maybe there's something that yeah. works for me that's free, but maybe a larger company might need something a little more reliable, like, or someone who has a store they rely on might want to spend more money to get stuff. So it was actually a mental shift for me. I feel bad admitting that, right? But like 10 years ago, the idea yep. of paying for something seemed like rude, or, you know, asking to charge for it. Dimi, I know that you yep. have some opinions on this. So like, I'll ask you, should plugins be free by law, or, you know, what make the case for why we should be charging for them?
Look, the short answer here is no, but let me talk a bit around it, because it's a very good question. It's a very good question. And it's very funny, like you said, it's 10 years ago. Yes, it was like that, right? 10 or more years ago, paying for a plugin, especially because we are in this free ecosystem, right? This is what WordPress grew on and was built on this free stuff, this free part. And there is a case to be made for free and also for paid. And I think a plugin, whether a plugin is free or paid, is a factor of multiple things, like the business model of the developer, the plugin complexity, for example, right? Or the features that are in there, the premium support that you are getting. But I think this, looking at it as a free and as a pro, might be maybe a bit too binary. I think the middle ground might be something that it's sort of in between, which is the freemium model. This is something we are practicing on Breezy. And how this works is we give you in free a lot, enough for you to create your website. But the more advanced features, like more advanced elements, I don't know, contact form integrations with different CRMs, or the bells and whistles, we sort of lock in the paid version of the plugin. I think free is great, but if you are basing your business or your website on something more advanced, it might be very interesting for you to open up and go on that paid version of pro version, especially for this advanced features. Get professional support usually, right, from the plugin developers. You get regular updates. This is something that that you also get. And one important factor that is not the last but not the least important factor that I think is not discussed a lot is the sustainability. This is very, very important for developers, because paid plugins provide us, the developers, with an income stream that let us sustain, right? The ongoing development, the supports, putting more features in, and so on and so forth. So the longer answer is no, not only free plugins, maybe the answer is somewhere in between, I think. So, yeah.
Muted. Yeah, so we are going to pivot to the Q&A from the audience. I think one of the first ones I that stands out. We have some great questions here. Can we hear your must-have plugin of choice? Does any of the panelists like want to have an opinion on that one? Must-have plugin of choice? Yeah, Daniel, why don't you start?
Yeah, for us, I mean, we use advanced custom fields all the time on every site. So that's one of the biggest ones for us. We have the pro version of that, and you know, we leverage it on every site we build.
Yep, I would second that, Daniel. It's a fantastic plugin. It's a fantastic tool. We use it on gravityforms.com too. I mean, I have to shout out for Gravity Forms. Obviously, it's a great tool, and you can accomplish a lot with forms and beyond, right? I mean, you really can do so much with Gravity Forms, building full infrastructure and application type interfaces and workflows right on top of WordPress. So a little bit more goes from basic to advanced, but you know, as a panelist, I kind of have to throw out the tool that is what we do every day.
You know, I want to get to this next question. It was a popular one. When to upgrade to premium versions? And this is related to what we were talking about earlier, where there actually, I don't even know if we really got into this. Let's talk about this for a second. In the plugin repository, you have free plugins, but many of them have the option to upgrade to a pro. And so the free plugin is going to offer you maybe three of the seven things, and it might be the three most requested things totally for free. But then if you need some of these extra features, or if you just want to support the developer, oftentimes there's that upgrade to pro. So when do our panelists think it's good to upgrade? They can tell it's time to upgrade to a premium version. And Angie, I'll let you start that one off.
Sure. Number one, I think if you need support, that's probably the absolute first thing. If you are someone who you have questions and you expect to get an answer to that question, upgrade for support, because the developers behind that takes time, right? Time is money. We all know time is money, and that's the way to show them that you want some of their time. Even though most good developers provide some level of support, even for free users, it is your way to say, I respect the time that you're giving to me, and I'm going to pay you for this support. That's probably number one. Number two is simply, do you have a business need that upgrading solves? If you don't have an actual business need that an upgraded feature or access to a new solution is going to provide for you, don't upgrade. But once you realize that I have something, a goal I'm trying to accomplish in my business that like maps to money, and the way to get there is to get access to additional features, then upgrade, because that's when you can start looking at, I'm going to be able to get a return on this money that I invested by getting access to these extra features. So that's how I would look at it.
Right on. And Dan, I'm going to toss that same question to you. When is it a good time to go premium?
Yeah, I mean, I really echo what Andy said. And I'll just also mention, like, just go ahead and take a look at what the premium features are. I feel like a lot of times, you know, you might get yourself into trouble where you didn't realize that certain aspects were in the premium version of it. So for instance, like we have, you know, like one thing I'll just call out is that sometimes email sending from a WordPress site will get shut off depending on your host provider. So having another way to send emails is important, especially for us, but not having a way to like have any log tracing of when that stuff happens, or that's some stuff that is the most of the time in buying a premium tier of the plugin. So just things like that, being very aware of like what the plugin offers at the premium level. And then like Angie said, if you do need that, or is that something that makes sense for what your use case is, then just go ahead and get it. But yeah, I think just like once you download a plugin, peruse what the options are if you go that premium route, and then from there kind of make your decision.
Right on. We have a question here. How can I tell what all of my plugins do after they've been installed? Do I actually need them? How can I easily see if all of my plugins are in use? And as far as that last question, I don't have the screen slide handy, but if you go to your dashboard and you go to plugins and you look at your list of current plugins, so not the add new, but just the list of plugins, you will be able to see which plugins are in use. So it'll say active or deactive, I think is what it says. And so from there is where you can see what's in use. But as far as the question here, do I actually need them? That's something that's kind of up to you. You might be working with a web developer who installed it, or maybe it was part of a theme that you got. And if you did get a theme, and they installed a plugin on there that you don't know, there's a chance that that's probably something crucial, like contact form 7 or something, right? It's probably something that's built into the theme. So you know, delete it at your own risk, but you can kind of play around, deactivate things and reactivate them, and check and see what works and what breaks your site. And as far as how can I tell what all of my plugins do after they've been installed, well, there's two things. First off, when you look at each of your plugins, you'll also be able to see, you know, whether it's active, whether it's up to date. You can check all those things. Last time it was updated, I think shows up. And there's two extra things. One is the settings. It's a hyperlink in there that if you click on settings, it usually takes you to the control panel for a plugin. So if it's something like Yoast, it'll take you to the Yoast plugin on the dashboard, so you can go through and customize things. But you can also click on, I believe, a more info, which will bring up basically the plugin repository description for those. So everything you're kind of asking there, how can you tell what the plugins do after they've been installed? Do you actually need them, which are in use? That's all on your plugin page. I hope that helps.
I'll pop in here real quick and say there is, it looks like there is a plugin in the repo. It's called Plugin Notes Plus. That actually does is a plugin to solve a plugin problem. But it is a plugin that essentially will help you answer the question, why did I ever install this plugin? Might give you a little bit more, information if you add some notes, and obviously it's an additional thing to manage, but might help out.
Yeah. And I think we have a follow-up coming in here. All right. And the follow-up question here, and Travis, I'll let you kind of continue this. Just because a plugin is active, does that mean it's in use? If it's marked active, is it in use?
Yeah, I mean, it is a great question. There are a couple different ways. If the question is about figuring that out, there are a couple different ways to probably figure that out. If you go and are familiar with inspecting a site, you can go to the front end, you can inspect a site with web dev tools, and you can actually see in the WP content folder if anything's being loaded. That might be a way if you're familiar with doing something like that. Does that help answer that question, Doc? Sorry,
I think so.
I was trying to post the Plugin Notes Plus the link. Might have missed the specifics.
So we have a question here. Has anyone had success in monitoring performance and configuration of active plugins? In other words, how can you tell if something's not great for your server load? Is anyone interested in taking a stab at that? Demi or Dan or Angie, have any thoughts on how to monitor, you know, performance based on plugins? Demi, it looks like you got something.
No, I actually don't. I was thinking how would you do that? And I was wondering if there is maybe a plugin that can help you with that, right? There is always a plugin that can help you with something. So it's a very good question, actually. And guys, if you know, please jump in. And I'm interested to test that out as well.
Yeah, that's a question that I think a lot of, well, for me personally, it's just a lot of intuition. It's a lot of hunch. I'm like, oh, this plugin's really bloated. I'm going to, but I have no science. I have nothing to back it up. I've never done, you know, a speed test, for instance, where I deactivate a plugin. Dan, do you have any thoughts on this?
No, we don't have anything specific like that. Usually I'll kind of like just get into dev tools and look at kind of the waterfall, like what's loading, and just try and figure out, you know, is this coming from, you know, the JavaScript, for instance, from this one plugin? That's kind of how I usually go about it personally. I don't really have a great tool outside of that. I know like Query Monitor is a plugin that some people would use for kind of assessing some of that stuff, but yeah, I guess I don't really have the perfect answer there.
On the other, if I might jump in a bit here, on the other flip of the coin, there are a couple of things you can ensure, you can do to ensure your performance, like great WordPress hosting, doing caching right, CDN networks that can deliver your content very fast based on the, so there are some things that you can do to of course this doesn't put out the performance monitoring and trying to always be better, but I wanted to, because I feel that monitoring is great, but if you don't do the first step right, like good hosting, caching, CDNs and everything, you put yourself in a bad situation and spend a lot of time on analyzing performance when you didn't do the first three steps right.
Right on. And, you know, we've had a ton of great questions. We are at time. So I'm going to pass the mic to our host, Lexi. And before I do, I just want to say it's been a real pleasure talking to all of the guests here. Thank you so much. And thanks to all the questions in the chat. Now, Lexi, thank you for putting together this awesome webinar, and I'll let you take it from here.
Yes, thank you. And thank you again to all of our panelists that were able to join. I know there were a ton of questions about what's your favorite plugin for security or things like that. Feel free to go check out WP Engine's most recent social posts on Twitter and LinkedIn, where we've kind of started some threads on plugins. I think that's a slippery slope. We all have our favorite plugins, but there's also so many plugins out there, which is why we're here today. In addition, just want to remind everyone, this is a three-part series. We don't often do huge series of webinars, but we know there's a lot to talk about. So next week, there will be a webinar on everything e-commerce and WooCommerce. And then following that, we've got a webinar on artificial intelligence plugins. I know we saw a lot of questions on those throughout the webinar today, but we kind of saved those questions for those webinars. If you're registered for this session, you'll get the reminder emails for the following sessions. So stay tuned for some following emails, and then we will be sending out the recording after we transcribe it today. Other than that, the Ultimate Guide to WordPress Plugins is a WP Engine publication that has roughly 100 pages of kind of every plugin that you should need to know, including plugins from everyone that is on the panel today. You will get that in an email, as well as that's on our resources page, relaunched as a 2023 edition. Other than that, thank you to everyone. Happy Tuesday, and we will see y'all soon. Thank you.